a very common natural viewpoint within the question of why we do not see evidence of alien life in the universe is the notion of some mitigating factor about star systems themselves that work against surface life on an Earth-like planet. The most famous and widely suspected for some is that Earth is not a common type of planet at all for any number of potential reasons, from the presence of the moon to moderate Earth's spin to plate tectonics not being a common phenomenon in the universe. But when you take all those factors together, it does seem reasonable to suspect that Earth life, and there are caveats here, is a very rare situation. On the other hand, life does not appear to have required much time to appear on Earth. The chemistry of simple life, based on that, may not be too sensitive to those factors, and tends to appear. But that begs the question, does it evolve? To a degree, yes it did on Earth, but remained simple until the first photosynthesis appeared, and then the advent of multicellular life. But those developments took a suspiciously long time to happen. Life on Earth was already long established when they finally happened. This might simply mean, and admittedly this is my suspicion, that the universe teems with simple life. But only occasionally does it go further, and even more occasionally results in technological intelligence. We just happen to be one instance of that, and we may never see another, unless we persist for potentially billions of more years. It may just be that we are at the very start of intelligent life in the Milky Way, and that the world of Star Trek, of many species interacting and obvious to each other, is not a matter of searching right now. There's nothing yet to find, but will be how it finally happens in the distant future, when they have had enough time to evolve. Maybe we simply do not live in the time of communication in the Milky Way. 2 or 3 billion years from now, however, it may look radically different. But the rare Earth hypothesis has a wild card. It only really affects surface life. If you have life arise inside an ice shell moon with a liquid ocean, all driven by internal heating rather than solar energy, then you have a full-on second way for life to arise independent from rare Earth. But that life may also never be able to evolve the way surface life did, and as a result may never gain the ability to leave its ocean under the ice. More broadly, however, is the idea of a rare solar system. We now know of thousands of exoplanet-bearing star systems, and this number is growing. One thing is for sure, planets themselves are not rare in this universe, and indeed almost certainly outnumber stars in this galaxy. But what we haven't seen yet is another solar system configured like ours. Our star system doesn't have an extremely common type of terrestrial planet in the universe, the so-called super-Earth. We simply do not currently have one. We might have at one time, and it got gravitationally kicked out, but if not, whatever circumstance that happened here regarding the solar nebula during planet formation prevented our star system from being average, apparently. Other questions can be asked about such things as the presence and orbital wanderings of Jupiter that might have made for an unusual set of circumstances. If so, thanks big guy. We don't know what we'd do without you, apparently. What involvement Saturn had in this remains shrouded. Saturn certainly likes its secrets. But the point is, the solar system does not appear to be a common configuration, and it's certainly possible that it influenced how the Earth formed and where, and was a factor in creating the conditions for surface life. But there's also panspermia and the idea that the reason it appears that life arose here as soon as it possibly could is because it didn't. It was transported here by rocks, blasted off another body, now termed lithopanspermia. This could have been Mars, but it also could have been a rock from another star system entirely, perhaps a star system in the Sun's birth cluster that was even better than this one for life. Sibling star systems to the Sun used to be much closer to each other in that cluster before they were dispersed as they are today. I wonder what the night sky looked like in those days. But there is one more possibility for a rarity in the solar system that until recently had not garnered much thought in astrobiology, and it is the Sun. leading to the rare sun hypothesis. We've been able to classify stars based on their temperature for a long time now, over a century, and we knew that our sun was certainly not the most common type of star in the universe. That goes to the red dwarfs, followed by the orange dwarfs. But Class G stars are still common, making up about 8% of the stars in the Milky Way. But those classes of stellar types are very broad. There are a huge and growing number of variations we know that can happen with individual stars in the same class. This is not a fully understood subject, as we find surprises still regarding stars varying from each other, but still within the same temperature range, or color as it's termed. So the questions are, is the Sun a rare variant of a kind of Type G star, and why might that be? In truth, we don't know, but we do have some rather intriguing clues. One of the first things we noticed when comparing the Sun to stars in its class is that it actually appears to be unusually quiet. It can seem hard to swallow. We see the Sun flare all the time. Coronal mass ejections hit our planet, and we see the Sun's assault as aurorae and power outages. But the reality is, if you compare the Sun's flaring to that of a red dwarf, especially a young one, the Sun today simply does not compare to the violence of the red dwarf. Red dwarf flares can be orders of magnitude stronger than the Sun's, as far as how large their flares are, which can reach out millions of miles further than the Sun's flares, and that process of fury may actually make the surfaces of terrestrial worlds that otherwise may have started with water and were habitable to be sterilized and stripped by the angry red dwarf. There has been some work that suggests that red dwarfs preferentially flare near their poles, meaning that the planets would be missed by them and be safe. But at the same time, our studies of the TRAPPIST-1 red dwarf system with the James Webb are turning out to be stripped, bare rock, at least so far. Though we should soon have an answer on TRAPPIST-1e, the most interesting member of that system. The first real clue from astronomy that the Sun might be unusually quiet for its class came from the Kepler spacecraft. Kepler was a photometer that looked for exoplanets transiting the face of their star, and indeed was the instrument that discovered Tabby's star. But to tease out the faint signature of passing planets, you need to have some kind of exception on just how noisy a type of star tends to be in the Kepler data. This was especially so for Type G stars in Kepler's field of view, if you're looking for Earth-sized worlds, which Kepler was really just barely on the cusp of being able to potentially do that. But it turns out that for the other Type G stars they were seeing, they were a full 50% noisier than our Sun is. None of them were as quiet as our star as far as could be determined. This actually turned out to be too noisy for Kepler to weed through, and as a result detected no Earth-sized worlds around Sun-like stars. The noise of the stars had been underestimated because our benchmark was the quietness of the Sun, and we didn't know it. But Earth-sized worlds were only ever just slightly, and optimistically even then, within Kepler's abilities. It had a limited budget and was out there to look for larger planets, and it found thousands and was a resounding success, and also some anomalies. Tabby's star was the most famous, but there were other strange light curves that the citizen scientists sifting through the light curves found that, to my knowledge, were never investigated further by professional astronomers. But there was a problem with all of this in that the Type G stars that Kepler was seeing in its field of view were all of different ages, some much younger than the Sun. We know that in general, red dwarfs tend to calm down as they evolve, and the Sun may have as well, and may have been much noisier in its youth than it is today, and if it was, then life survived the Sun's tumultuous youth. This would undermine the Kepler rare Sun data, because if your data sample on noise covers too many younger stars, then it skews, and the Sun may become typical again for its type. But then came another study. About 5 years ago, Reinhold and colleagues, linked to the paper in the description below, specifically looked at Type G Sun analogs with a similar spin rate and similar ages, and eliminated young stars from the study. Lo and behold, The result was that the Sun was indeed quieter than many other stars very similar to it in age, but that other quiet ones were found. The Sun was then in the lowest third of quietness for G-type stars, but not unique. But ultimately, this is all only a possible clue as to whether very specific, very quiet stellar conditions could affect the ability for surface life to arise near a star. Part of the problem is in just what effects of a more active, but not insanely so, star might have on a planet like Earth. It might be that the Sun has had active periods like this, and here we are. It also opens the specter that maybe the Sun has been relatively quiet its whole life for some unknown reason, and the worst it's done is the occasional superflare, which did not destroy all life on this world. And then, at some point, the Sun becomes far more active than at any point in its history and crosses the threshold for what life can handle. And finally, it could well also be that an active young flaring star was the kickstarter for the precursor chemical reactions in Earth's atmosphere, such as carbon dioxide production, that was essential for a planet to be warm enough for life. We just don't know. But this still does not affect subsurface life. The ice shells can still exist in most any star system if they're of sufficient distance from their star. And the subsurface life on Earth, the oldest life on this planet, would persist, protected by rock. The Sun still wins in the end and is what will finally cause the extinction of all life on Earth. It will be the Sun's increasing luminosity, eventually evaporating the oceans, making it even hotter here, finally turning the planet's crust entirely molten. Nothing survives that. But the rare Sun hypothesis is interesting because we really did not think about it much before. We were just assuming that the Sun was typical for what it is, but it may not be. And that may play into future thoughts on the Great Silence. Maybe it was a lack of silence in another way that caused it. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing Saturn suspiciously. Ring system, hexagons, unclear history. If there are any planets in the solar system hiding something, it's Saturn. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.